Hello?
Hello, Sydney. Remember me?
What do you want?
I want you. It's showtime.
Then why don't you show your face, you fucking coward?
My pleasure.
And welcome to episode 26 of Once Upon a Nightmare. I am your host Lorraine, and I'm here to discuss the horrors of the world, be it fictional or real. This week we are going very much fictional, with a guest, with a movie that is part of one of the biggest franchises. It's Scream 2.
So this week I am joined by Griff from the Paul and Griff Show. Hi Griff.
How are you doing? You alright?
Yeah, good. How are you?
Oh, living the dream. All good.
So for those who don't know who you are and your podcast, why don't you tell them about it?
Hi, Griff from the Paul and Griff Show. We pretty much chat movies all the time, do a bit of movie news and some crazy like top sixes. But yeah, we just chat films.
I do like your movie news. You go into quite detail sometimes with that, don't you?
We do. Sometimes the news dries up, but the good thing is we keep on getting movie trailers, which makes it really easy to talk about. And we just kind of see what kind of grabs our attention for that week. Obviously, it was a bit slow at first, what with the pandemic and nothing's coming out, but we seem to keep getting releases. It's okay when Netflix are releasing a film every week, so
yeah.
You always get like a Netflix trailer. But yeah, we just tried to add in a little bit of news just to break up the episode a little bit.
Yeah, no, it's cool. So, no, I've listened to them and I do like the news. And I can imagine at the moment it's quite hard to get a lot of the movie news that you would have got maybe a year and a half ago.
I know. Whereas like we just grab a couple of things. I think when this all comes and this all cinemas are open and all that, maybe the movie news bit will be a bit of a longer segment. But at the moment we just grab some snippets and kind of just if people don't like the film, it just gives them something else to listen to.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, cool. So obviously this is horror you're coming on to. So are you a fan in general of horror?
Yeah, I love horror. I do love the teen slasher horror genre, like especially. I'm more kind of...
Oh, really?
Yeah, rather than like ghosts and stuff like that. I'm not saying I don't enjoy that, but I do love the teen slasher genre.
So what would be your favourite then? Your kind of favourite horror genre? I'm a big psychological horror fan. So what would your kind of horror... So obviously the slasher. So what would be yours, your favourite slasher film?
Oh, the godfather of slasher films, Scream. The creator of the teen slash genre. massive Scream fan. I, for some reason, just loved it. And I never get bored of watching it. I think it's very hip. It's very... young, very fresh. I do think it kind of turned the genre, it pumped into life.
It brought the horror genre back, didn't it?
It really did, because you've got your kind of Halloweens and all that. I think that was getting a little bit tired, obviously Friday the 13th and like Jason Takes Manhattan and all that kind of stuff. I just found this had characters that were relatable and you kind of cared about them, whereas all these other films, you kind of just get introduced to people just for them to die. And you don't really know them. There's not really that many reoccurring characters. And whereas he can kind of relate, you kind of, you know some of these characters. And I like the fact that this could actually happen, which I know kind of has people like dressing up and just killing people. It just felt fresh.
Yeah, what they say, because when I think of horror myself, like I always go back to more of the 80s. Obviously, you know, I'm a big fan of like Silence of the Lambs, which is in the 90s. But I feel like, and it's been said as well, that that Scream kind of brought the horror franchise back a bit. Because then obviously you had I Know What You Did Last Summer and then all these kind of teen slashers, as you call them, kind of came out after that. So yeah, no, I agree. But I seen Scream, the first one, when it first came out, and I thought it was just brilliant. And I loved the, sorry, spoilers, there will be spoilers all the way through this. And I loved, because obviously I'm a massive Drew Barrymore fan. She's the same age as me. I think she's a year younger. And obviously I followed her from her ET days and Firestarter. And when you see her at this, you think, oh, Drew Barrymore. And then she's dead within seconds.
And she's the poster girl. She's the poster. What the fuck? And the person you know, she's the poster girl. And how genius to like take her out in 5 minutes or 10 minutes.
Oh, I thought it was amazing, because I think it kind of, like, I think when they do that, it's like no one's safe.
All bets are off.
You know?
All bets
are off, because she, at the time, thinking about it, obviously you've got Courtney Cox off the whole Friends thing, but Drew Barrymore would have been, yeah, she would have been the biggest film star.
I think Friends was only like into like two seasons.
I don't think it was like 94, 95 that started, wasn't it?
I know. I think Neve Campbell had Party of Five, but I don't think she had a big part in that.
No.
There was no one really big, like David Arquette. I would think he was kind of unknown, really.
I didn't really know who he was back then, but I knew who Drew Barrymore was. Like, do you know what I mean? So, yeah, no, that's a really good choice. But you were saying about how relatable and all that kind of stuff, but the idea for this film actually did come, it is based on, I think loosely kind of, on like Danny Rowlands. He was the Gainesville Ripper who did murder some students and stuff in Florida. So I think, you know, it kind of does have, that element to it of something that could actually happen. And that's the thing about slasher films, you know, they could happen in a sense. Like, I know with your Michael Myers and your Jasons and Krugers and stuff, like, they're kind of these superhuman people, so it's a bit different. Whereas Ghostface, you know, you could actually kill him, whereas with the others, they never seem to die.
And yeah, like, people just can put masks on and kill, and just because someone's done it, someone else can put a mask on and reenact it. That's the scary reality of it, really.
Yeah, I know, exactly. And I suppose that's what makes it easy to kind of do like the franchise, you know, because we have what, I think Scream 2 came out like a year later in 97. They were filming, they were writing Scream 2 while filming Scream 1. Scream 3 was 2000, but Scream 4 didn't actually come out until 2011, which was quite a big gap, I thought. And now we have Scream 5, which is apparently going to be released in 2022, which is like 26 years later. How do you feel about the fifth one?
I'm well excited. When four came out, it was like it was Christmas again, and I really enjoyed it. Five, I like it. I'm well excited. I don't know how I feel about some of the rumors and some of the theories that they want to do.
Ooh, obviously, what have you heard?
Fred Matthew Lillard wants to come back. So are they going to make it that Stu's kind of not dead? Which, I didn't like the fact that the end of three, they kind of undid one by saying that he was the mastermind behind it. I don't undo any kind of that.
Well, which I will mention in a bit once we start talking about Scream 2, but I spotted something in Scream 2 that I've never seen before.
Is there someone in the background of the party?
Yeah. I'd never seen that before, and I spotted that this time. Okay, might as well say, which was Matthew Lillard when Mickey was hugging him. And I was like, I never seen that before. But then I was like, how could he not be dead after that death? After that, you know, what fell on his head?
TV. Not a flat screen TV you get nowadays. A big ass telly on his face. And he's publicly come out and said, I'll happily do it. But knowing how Matthew Lillard's career is, I don't kind of blame him. He's not really kind of set the... I do think he's a really great actor. Apart from the Scooby-Doo movies, I think he's not really been in a lot. I hope if he's in it, it's a flashback. Obviously, you can do great things with technology nowadays with aging. I just don't want them to get silly with it. I actually thought before they were going to kill off some of the main cast and we're going to have a fresh new group of people to kind of follow. So it's really weird that the main three still survived.
Yeah, but I like them in it.
I
I
do, but
want
you're
them
gonna
in
get
it.
when we talk about two, like you're gonna hear a little bit like Dewey should just go. Just
It's
go.
not for the want of trying. It's not for the want of
Not for the
trying.
want of
That poor
trying.
git.
But yeah, I'm very excited about it because obviously in the middle of all of this, you had the Scream TV series, which I did watch series one. I kind of gave up, and I don't think I even bothered watching season two.
Oh, I did.
Did it get
I watched them.
better?
I don't remember them. No, I don't remember it, but I remember I enjoyed it. So I if I if season three came out, I'd need to watch them. I'd need to watch it again.
I
And
remember
then
that.
because my memory is so bad, I forget everything. So whenever I rewatch a film, it's like it's new to me because my memory's so shit.
I just know they made the decision not to use the mask, like the iconic mask, which I don't know. Scream is the mask, and but yeah, I do love it, and I'm hoping five is be interesting because obviously Wes Craven, God bless him, is kind of no longer with us, and this is the first film without his input on it. So,
But I am glad that, like, especially Neve Campbell, I absolutely love her. I met her once at
yeah,
Comic Con.
oh,
Yeah, I've got a
amazing.
picture up on my wall, of her, where she I paid to get her, and as you can see, if you look behind me, you can see a picture on the mantelpiece of like a tall woman.
Oh, yeah,
That's me and that's me and Sigourney Weaver.
I can make out this Sigourney. I can make out that
Fucking love Sigourney
Sigourney.
Weaver. Yeah, so I went and met Sigourney Weaver, but I also paid to go and see Neve Campbell. And when I went up to meet her, it was literally you go up, meet her, she says hello, you sign and go. But her pen didn't work, so I got an extra minute with her and we were just
Nice,
chatting. I
nice.
know. She looks amazing. And this was I think this was in, oh, 2000, I don't know, maybe I had my kid, so maybe 2017. I can't remember it wasn't that long ago, and she looks amazing.
She looked
So,
great in I think the last
yeah.
thing I've seen her in was like House of Cards.
Oh, I've never
Well,
seen
never
that, but
she doesn't come into it to like the fourth or fifth season, but yeah, she always looks great. And she should be in more stuff. She hasn't really, she's kind of gone back to TV and not really been any big main film parts really. But I think she's a
yeah,
great
she was kind.
actress.
Oh, I think she's brilliant, and she's got because, like, obviously, The Craft, great film. She's kind of one of those actresses that is amazing and is in been in some big films like this and The Craft and stuff like that, but she never kind of made that A-list
No. Yeah.
celebrity like your Tom Cruises and stuff, which I think she should have,
Yeah.
but you find that with some actors and actresses, you feel like they should kind of have more of a status than they do, but there's probably the plus side to that where she gets to have a little bit of a private life, compared to them who are followed around, because you don't really know much about Neve Campbell,
No, she was kind of not mysterious, but yeah, she keeps her private life quite private. You don't really hear any rumors about her.
No, and I'd be honest with you, like teenager and 20-year-old me used to love all the celebrity gossip, whereas now I don't really care. Like I like the film stuff. I'm not really interested, so it kind of suits me. But teenage me, I would have wanted to know it
I love a bit of gossip. But you're right. I think now, because being older myself and wiser, you kind of feel for them and they should have their privacy. I think George Clooney said it. I think George Clooney said it best when he was like, everyone's jealous of me, but I can't walk down the streets of New York, like, ever.
Exactly, because I seen an interview actually, because with Jennifer Aniston, and she said that the day before Friends was released or something, they got to go to Vegas, and the guy who was running it said, "Enjoy yourself because this is the last time you're going to get to do anything without somebody knowing who you are." So they all went off. The six of them had a great time, and then the next day, they've never been able to do
No.
anything really since, like, yeah, so you're right, it's kind of it's a lot to I couldn't handle it, that's for sure.
No, and I think
I wouldn't want it.
some celebrities are really patient about it, but I've known where people said, oh, I bumped into such and such and kind of tried to talk to him and he was a little bit offish. I'm like, I said, he probably gets it all the time.
I know, he's probably just had a row with his wife.
He probably can't even have a pint without like, oh, I know who you are. It's just, yeah, so you feel for him, but I suppose it comes with the territory, really.
I know. When I was 17, I was in a nightclub, and I shouldn't have been in a nightclub. And I think Gary Lineker was there, and he used to play for, was it Port? No, Tottenham Hotspur. Did he play for Tottenham Hotspur?
Yeah.
And I was in love with him. And I, when I was 17, I looked about 10, and I walked up to him and was like, "Gary, will you dance with me?" And he was like, "No." I was just like, "Okay."
A savage.
I know. And I swear to God, honestly, when I was 17, I did. I looked about 10. I shouldn't have been in there. And I was devastated. And then I never liked him after that.
After that, like, he's dirt.
Yeah, fuck him. Look what he's missed out on. He could have been with this. We are going way off track here. Okay, let's get talking about the film that is Scream 2.
Windsor College students were murdered last night during a sneak preview of the new movie Stab.
It's starting again, Randy.
This has nothing to do with us.
Randy, a guy in a ghost mask hacked up two people in the movie theater telling our life story.
Hi, Gail Weathers, author of the Woodsboro Murders. Do you think the killer will strike again?
We have no evidence that this is a serial killer.
It's a classic case of life imitating art, imitating life.
Are you suggesting that someone's trying to make a real-life sequel?
Do you think someone's trying to duplicate Woodsboro?
It looks like it.
I think you have a copycat on your hands, Chief.
Hello?
Hello, Sydney. Remember me?
What do you want?
I want you. It's showtime.
Police are everywhere.
If there is some freaked out psycho trying to follow in Billy Loomis's footsteps, you probably already know.
The way I see it, someone's out to make a scene. So it's our job to observe the rules of the scene. Number one, the body count is always bigger. Number two, death scenes are always much more elaborate.
Just want to sit here and wait and see who drops next?
I'm not interrupting anything, am I?
So Scream 2 was released in December 1997 in Canada and the US, but it didn't hit the rest of the world until 1998. It was directed by the great late Wes Craven and written by Kevin Williamson. It's an 18 and on for just over 2 hours and had a budget of about $24 million and grossed, over $172 million worldwide. This film, I was actually in America at the time it came out, but it did come out when Titanic came out. Do you remember Titanic coming out?
Yeah, I remember Titanic coming out. I think when Titanic came out, Leonardo DiCaprio wasn't cool. As in, like, for guys, for, I don't know, an 18-year-old lad, like, it wasn't cool to go and watch Leonardo DiCaprio movies. But now, like, a little bit older, DiCaprio's amazing in everything he does. But back then he was still kind of cheesy DiCaprio that all the women love, and it's like, I'm not watching a DiCaprio movie, because I remember Romeo and Juliet, which was amazing, but I think because I studied Romeo and Juliet, I did watch Romeo and Juliet. But yeah, I remember Titanic. It's still a great film.
It is. I went to see that at the cinema in America when it came out, and I remember Jackie Brown. Do you remember the film Jackie Brown?
Very well,
that was at the
well.
Same time. But I don't remember Scream 2. So that's weird, because I was there and they all kind of came out, around December time. But with this one, we've talked a little bit about the first one. But in the second edition, we leave Woodsboro and follow Sidney Prescott, played by the great Neve Campbell, and Randy Meeks, played by Jamie Kennedy, to Windsor College in Ohio. On the opening weekend of a movie known as Stab, which is a film based on the real events of the Woodsboro murders, two students, Maureen Evans, played by Jada Pinkett, now Pinkett Smith, and Phil Stevens, played by Omar Epps, are murdered. Evans is murdered in front of a crowded cinema while everyone watched a movie, thinking it's simply a publicity stunt, so no one helps. It soon becomes clear that Ghostface is back and intent on killing Sydney and anyone else that gets in their way. This turn of events sees the return of Gail Weathers, played by Courtney Cox, and Deputy Dewey, played by David Arquette, and chaos ensues. That's like my favourite line.
It so does.
It does. So, you've mentioned how Scream 1 is like your favourite movie. How does that compare to Scream 2? Did you like this film?
I did. I think it's kind of a near on like perfect sequel. Randy says it perfect, like rules of a sequel. You kind of up the notch with more killings, more stuff. It's almost like a film within a film. And I think it's very clever with the whole cinema stuff and them going to a film and they're thinking of a publicity stunt, which again is quite scary. You can actually imagine that kind of stuff would happen. And obviously you're going to see a film called Stab, and you see that, you think, oh my God, this is part of that. This is a great show here. And how like haunting it might be that actual person, like, and obviously everyone's going out buying Ghostface costumes as soon as Scream come out. So they really do touch on how realistic it could be. But I love it. I love the first two because I don't think they intentionally go out to be like a whodunit. Mm. But you do try to work out like who it is.
Oh, definitely. Did you find the whole, because obviously the start of it, they're in the cinema, they're watching it. Everyone's losing their shit, running around, shouting, screaming, popcorn flying and stuff like that. And as you mentioned, people dressed up in the masks. I find that so stressful because I'm a cinema person who I don't even like to hear someone breathe and it annoys me. I'm really bad. I don't actually go to the cinema much anymore because I just can't stand the noise. But it's, you know, because what you said, how she's doing all that, she's getting stabbed, no one's taking any notice. But the noise of everyone, like, could you imagine going to a cinema and seeing that?
Especially if a film you're excited to see. I don't like when people talking during the trailers.
I know, you want to see the trailers.
This is the best bit. I haven't even come for the film. I've come for the trailers. But yeah, I think because it plays on your anxiety and you kind of, oh my God, how stressful all this is. And I think it kind of hits a nerve a little bit. And then obviously very unsettling that all of a sudden, like, she's getting stabbed.
This girl's being murdered, yeah. Yeah.
Really.
And when they start to realise, they're like, you can see a few of them, can't you? That they, because it's kind of got this weird shot and the few of them are kind of like, is this happening, isn't it? And then they all kind of slowly start to realise that, okay, maybe this is. They either think that it's a bit too realistic and they don't like it, or some of them think that it's actually happened. I wasn't quite sure what it was, but it's one of the two.
The shot where she gets up on stage and just collapsed, that's I don't think I even knew who Jada Pinkett was like back then. It's only like when you kind of watch it nowadays, like, oh my God, that's Will Smith's wife. Because she's quite I don't know if she's like bigger actress back then. But again, to kill off someone.
Yeah, no, I don't know what she was in. But obviously she went on to have an amazing career and still does. But I thought it was a really good intro, and it's kind of like Scream 1. It kind of hits you, you know, really quickly that something's going on here, because obviously with Drew Barrymore dying, it was a big shock to the system. And then they're at this and it's a big shock to the system for someone to die. And then they just kind of smooth into Sydney at university.
Yeah, I think like the phone's ringing, and I think it's very, I don't know if it's technology obviously back at the time, but obviously back then, obviously it was the first ever week you could actually see who's calling you. So I thought it was very good when she picked up the phone and like, who is this? I'm like, okay, I'll tell you who it is. And I thought that was a very, okay, technology's changed and she isn't as phased. I suppose they could take the sequel in one of two ways, but here you can see, like, obviously it happens a lot. It's followed her a little bit, but, like, she's literally, like, yeah, I've,
well, she's used to it, isn't she? She's probably used to it at this stage. She gets them all. But I did. There was another thing actually, because her roommate Hallie, played by Elise Neal, she comes in, and I never noticed this before either. But the Freddy Krueger jumper hanging in the closet.
Oh, I never noticed that.
Yeah, next time you watch it, just look behind. They've got a Freddy Krueger. And I was like, it's so weird, like, because you're probably like me. You watch the same film sometimes, a couple of times. And I've seen Scream 2 many times, and I never noticed it before. Just like the Matthew Lillard thing, I'd never noticed that before. And I was like, you know, so it's, I just love the way, because obviously Krueger is a Wes Craven thing. And I do love how they stick these little things in, because in the first one, they do it with the janitor.
Yeah.
So I just thought that was a nice little touch. But yeah, and then obviously they bring it into Sydney finding out about the murders, and then we know that it's all going to start up again.
It's all happening again. And I thought it was clever, like, because at first you're like, oh, they just killed two strangers. Like, what's this got to do with? Then you find find out the names all have like a reason.
Maureen Evans
that
and Phil Stevens.
They've been chosen.
Yeah,
which. Very, very powerful beginning. I remember, like, before seeing Scream 2, all the rumours. I think I heard about the cinema scene before seeing it. Mm. Oh, those are people with masks on in the cinema, and you're expecting it. When you see it, it's just kind of haunting. But yeah, I'll have to look out for the Freddy Krueger.
Yeah, like I said, I've seen that film probably a good 6 times or something, and I'd never spotted it before until that thing. But that's what I like about film, is like you're watching movies and you, like, how many times have you spotted something that you didn't notice before, and it's only something small, but you're kind of like, oh, I never seen that before. But and I think it, with that scene as well, it kind of also gives us the first scene, it gives us like set signs that there's two killers, because like when Phil Stevens walks into the toilet and those two ghost face kind of look at him, and you know, when Cece's on the phone, you know, Sarah Michelle Gellar's character, we see a guy in the background while she's on the phone. You know, there's things that kind of suggest it's two killers, that kind of, I suppose, repeating what happened in Woodsboro. But what do you think of the whole kind of like, because obviously this film and the first one, they really mock the whole horror genre. You know, because like Cece's running up the stairs, and then when Sydney says she's running up the stairs when she should be running out the door, you know, do you like the whole comedy aspect that they have, where they completely rip horror apart?
I do, because it's not like rip it like slapstick, but I think I think it just shows, like, it's easy for us to watch TV and be like, oh my god, why are you going up the stairs and out the door? But when you're actually being chased and your mind's not thinking straight, you're just you're just crazy. I kind of feel like it takes the mickey out of horror in the case of, like, it's a nod to it. Because I think on the DVD for Scream 1, I think the trivia's like, it name drops like 32 like horror movies. So some stupid figure like that. So I just like that it kind of tongue-in-cheek kind of way, but I think in the way that, like, it's a respect to it, and it may be stupid that I'm going up the stairs, but I've made a scene where, like, it's, I'm gonna really panic, and that's the why I've chosen to go up the stairs, because I'm just trying to get away.
I thought, because another thing I didn't really take much notice of before, you mentioned the whole teen slasher thing, how many, like, teen, like, you've got stars kind of are in this, like the whole Sarah Michelle Gellar off of Buffy. Did you watch Buffy? I wasn't a Buffy person. Did you
watch? Yeah, I watched Buffy. I don't know if this was only when I don't know if season one had just come out, but
I think Buffy started in like 96, 95, 96.
Yeah,
was it?
So she wasn't really a household name yet.
Okay.
But because I don't know, even though I watched Buffy, I was a bit late to the party. I don't think I started watching until season 4. One of those were like, this is supposed to be good. I'll kind of been watch it, but yeah, that scene, you got Josh Hartnett, that
Dawson's Creek.
He kind of was in one scene, which I thought we'd see more of him.
Because you had, and like, it was like the whole Tori Spelling and Luke Wilson thing, and Heather Graham and
David Schwimmer.
Like that. So
David Schwimmer is David Schwimmer plays old Billy, don't he, in Stab?
No, that was Luke Wilson.
Oh, is Luke Wilson? Was they? Oh, David Schwimmer gets mentioned.
No, David Schwimmer. Yeah, because they do the whole Friends thing, like it was my head and Jennifer Aniston's body, and you know, David Schwimmer plays it. Yeah, but yeah, I think that's the one thing they really do kind of bring in everybody. Like I thought Sarah Michelle Gellar's character was quite interesting actually, because she was so harsh.
Yeah.
Like she was really hard. Like, do you know what I mean?
She was supposed to be even harsher. I think I've read like she was really supposed to be like, oh, is this your scary voice and all that. I think she was really supposed to, but I think they told.
Yeah.
I think they told her to like
calm it down a bit.
Like calm it down a bit. Like you're supposed to be scared a little bit. Like you're gonna die like in this scene. We don't really want you to kind of. But yeah, I think earlier scripts. She wanted to actually be, I don't know, because Buffy got to her, like, I'm supposed to be a kick-ass, like, vampire killer, so voice isn't going to scare me. But, yeah, she's very good in the scenes that she's in, and she is kind of almost bratty.
I was kind of watching her, and I was like, this is obviously the character and not Sarah Michelle Gellar. I don't know her. And I was like, my God, she comes across as such a bitch. She really does come across as such a bitch. Like, and I think the problem is with that is that you obviously you don't want anyone to die in that fashion, but you don't care about her.
No.
Do you know what I mean? Like, you care about Hallie and you care about Sydney and Dewey and all that kind of stuff, but you don't care about her. So kind of like these additional characters, like I think they almost should have killed off, you know, the two, like
the sorority sisters.
The sorority. Oh, and when I watch this, because like when you're watching that scene where they come up and they're trying to like talk to Sydney about pledging and all this kind of stuff, and you can see Mickey, played by Timothy Oliphant, who's kind of there looking at it and going, Jesus Christ. And I was watching them and I was like, do people actually fucking carry on like this? Like, oh my God, like if two girls or boys come up and spoke to me like that, I'd be like, what are you doing? This is so annoying.
And it's interesting, like she went on and played, I don't know if you've ever seen Urban Legend, but obviously she ends up, again, spoiler like alert, like she ends up being the killer in that, which I thought was clever for her to take from that. But yeah, the sorority sisters should have got it. they, otherwise, they just kind of feel like a real pointless kind of addition to the movie, really.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely would have been like Sydney in that scene, you know, when he was like, are you going to dress like them? She's like, that's not going to happen. That would have been. But it was just, but I think it's interesting because obviously I've seen this as well back in the 90s, how you look at things. Because back then that wouldn't have annoyed me as much. Whereas now I'm just like, oh, I couldn't stand those girls. Like, do you know what I mean? I just would not have wanted to know them. But I think, you know, obviously that's probably the whole point of it. No one wanted to, like, why? But I suppose that's a big culture in America, isn't it? The whole
sororities and
sorority and frat thing.
I suppose it plays on the whole, because obviously he gives his, whatever they're called,
alphabet. Letters.
He gave his letters
to
Sid, and that kind of ties in with him getting tied up on, like, the cross. So I suppose it's part of college, isn't it? American college for fraternities and sisterhoods.
Well, I because I used to live in America. I lived in America in my 20s, and I lived with an American girl, and I used to ask her questions about the schools, you know. And I was like, "Is it really that real? Like the way, you know, because you watch these films and the popular kids, and it seems a lot more extreme than what I remember it being like when I went to school." And she was like, "It's worse." She goes, "It's so much worse." And I was like,
"Toned down."
She says, yeah, that's what she said. She goes, it's a lot worse. But yeah, it's, oh God, I couldn't deal with that. Like as an English Irish person, I just couldn't deal with that. I was kind of, okay, spoiler alert coming up, but like Mickey, I kind of got, what does this say about me? But I was kind of more relatable to him sometimes, like with his kind of the way he was towards people.
He plays a really good part. He plays a really good part in it.
Such a good part.
I didn't realise until, like, not on this rewatch, but I think I watched it, like, because we covered, like, the whole Scream kind of trilogy. how little he's in. Like after the I think I love you kind of scene,
yeah,
you don't really see him until the big reveal. I remember him being in more. I remember him being in it more. All of a sudden, like from that scene, you don't see him again. So you kind of think he can't be him because he was just a friend and he's just forget
but
about
this
him.
Time I obviously knew it was okay. Spoiler alert, Mickey's one of the killers. I obviously knew at this time that Mickey was. I never copped onto it, like obviously on my first watch. And but did you, one thing I noticed, I was like, when all commotion is going on, especially when the press is there and all that kind of stuff, he's not phased at all. No. And he's filming everything. And then obviously we see that scene later on with Dewey and Gail showing all this footage. So like there's so many. And like the Matthew Lillard scene, when Matthew Lillard is at the sorority party and he hugs him, like Mickey hugs him. Do you know what I mean? And there's like so many cues as to it's Mickey, but I never got any of them until this watch.
Yeah, because...
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, because after you see it, you're like, oh, I should have known this. Like, I think the only clue that it's the mum is, I think when Randy dies, he's got like a kiss mark on his hand, or his, I can't remember now where it's on, but there's lipstick on there, and I think it's the only clue that there's a female.
Well, the only reason I know this is because I seen it online. I didn't figure this out for myself. So, and this was today, you know, when he's being killed,
yeah,
in the car, in the van thing, and there's TV on in the background, that news reporter is her, and they're like, yeah, I never seen that. I didn't even spot that. I could see it was a female, but I didn't take much notice of it because I was too busy with that. And I wasn't expecting it to be her, but when you think about it, she was, while Mrs. Loomis, Laurie Metcalf, wasn't a big character in this, she was a big character in the sense that they made a point of making sure she was there a lot and being annoying to Gail Weathers. Like, she was there a lot, you know.
And she was never with Sid. She was never in a scene with Sid until the end. So that's clever. But then...
Yeah.
You think Courtney Cox would... Because obviously Billy Loomis has died and they'd report it. At first you think, surely they must investigate who the mum is. But then... As Sid said, like, she looks a hell of a lot different. She's lost a hell of a lot of weight.
A lot of work and stuff, yeah. Yeah.
But that was clever. And the motive is there.
Yeah.
The motive is totally 100%. There.
And good old-fashioned revenge.
And I love the way that Mickey's just a psycho. He just wants to blame the movies.
What do you think... Actually, I think it's a really interesting topic, because obviously... Without going into things, there's been situations where stuff has happened because of what they've seen or read, like Slender Man, for instance, that there's one. You know, what do you think about the whole... Because I think some guy did something once because of Call of Duty. Some kid killed someone once because of Call of Duty. I think he was only a kid. I think he was definitely under 18. What do you think with regards to violence and people committing crimes and blaming, like, movies or computer games or something like that?
It's hard because you don't know what's going on. You don't know someone's mental health. To encourage it, obviously, 20 years ago, me would be like, it's just an excuse. Like, it's easy to blame the movies. It's easy to play the games. But I think as society's changed, and some people are glued to, like, their TVs, that I kind of see it, but in the same way, there are kind of warnings in place and stuff. It's a very tricky topic, but I don't think anything we see should be to blame. But some people's mental health kind of, I can see it could trigger them to kind of go and do it.
Yeah, no, I don't blame film at all. Like, obviously, there's this scene, and here he goes, they were stabbed while watching the movie called Stab, you know, this type of thing. I don't blame anything, to be honest with you. I think because there's the, like, obviously I do true crime stuff. I think there's a whole thing where, you know, you and me could have exactly the same horrific upbringing, for example, and you could turn out fine and I could turn out not fine. And I think it's the way I'm kind of built. It's the way you're built. And I think, you know, I think there's so few instances where people do these things because they've watched something on telly. Do you know what I mean? And if you take film, like horror in film or whatever you want to call it, away, or in games, then you have to take away a lot of other things too.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So while I think people unfortunately do see things in films, I think it's more that it's a way that they do it. So I think it's like if they see a film where someone's like stabbing and they already have it in them to do those things, then that's kind of how they pick it, because they want to be like that person, so to speak, if you know what I mean. But I don't think, like, obviously you should stop. But then I have the luxury of saying that because I haven't been affected by someone. And that's the way I always kind of look at things. It's like, it's easy to have an opinion about something so serious when you haven't had to experience it.
Totally. And like, you know, like Billy says in Scream 1, like, movies doesn't create psychopaths. Movies make psychopaths more creative.
Exactly. And that's it, in a fucking nutshell.
Such a powerful line.
Yeah.
Which obviously also could be a little bit behind, like, I know Wes Craven didn't write it, but I'd like to think Wes Craven, obviously being like one of horror's greatest creators, has put that in there to be like, my movies don't make psychos. Their mental health is already gone. It may give people some creativity, which obviously isn't his fault.
But that could come from a Stephen King book. That could come from anything.
Well, anything on TV nowadays, obviously, because TV is the new. TV is the new cinema, with TV programs being more gripping. Like, what do you do? How much do you tone it down? You see people having affairs on TV. Does that influence people to go and have affairs? And it would be,
where does it stop?
Where does it stop? And it's a very tricky subject. But I don't blame movies or games, and but it affects people in different ways.
No, exactly. And I think that's like with any case. And I think with games, you have a lot of, and films, you have a lot of like 15s and 18s and all that kind of stuff out there. And like you said, we've got like Netflix and Now TV and Amazon and all that kind of stuff. You know, if your mum and dad is in bed, like when I was a kid, like I fell in love with horror when I was in single digits. I'd never seen a horror film. When I fell in love with horror, I used to go to the video shop and pick up video cases. And that's how I did it, because I couldn't get a horror film, you know. And whereas now, you know, you just put on the telly and it's there. So there's no control over it. So someone who's 13 can watch an 18. And some of the 18s out there, no fucking 13-year-old should be watching them.
Well, no.
You know, whether it's the horror or the sex or whatever. And I think that's the thing. Everything's too accessible nowadays.
It's massively accessible. And, like, I always knew our TV code was 1234. Like, I can watch any parental lock. Is, as you say, it is massively accessible. And kids are getting given mobile phones when they're, like, again, in single digits. And there's websites that can show you horror films. It's too easy. If you want to watch it, it's too easy to be able to watch it.
Yeah. And as whereas you say, now you like,
they shouldn't.
No, of course they shouldn't. I've loved horror since I was in single digits, but my horror, like, I remember my brother watching Evil Dead 2 and I was like peeking through the keyhole. No one knew I was peeking through the keyhole, but I was. And if I got caught, which I think I did, I'd have gotten in a lot of trouble. And I did. You know, or like somebody rented it and you went over to your friend's house and their parents didn't give a shit. You know, that type of thing. But in my house, I think Jaws was like the horror that that we saw, maybe The Omen and Amityville had pushed, but I think I was a bit older then. But yeah, it just didn't happen. Whereas now, like, I have a child now and she has a tablet, but it's a kid's one.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? But yeah, it's going to be a lot harder to monitor.
Yeah.
Monitor that. And so while I can see, like, you know, I think Mickey's thing is really interesting. I'm going to blame the movies. I think, you know, it's kind of, I would have, to be honest with you, part of me was gutted that we didn't get to see a trial, because it would have been really interesting to watch someone.
That would have been good.
Actually sit and, you know, because you kind of see Mickey all the way through and he's kind of got this real, like, he everyone kind of irritates him apart from, like, his mates. And then when the whole killing, you know, when they're on stage and the killing thing happens, he, like, turns into a completely different character. Like, yeah. He's a fucking psycho. Do you know what I mean?
Totally.
And I he's such a good actor, and I like that about him. And he so believes what he's saying. I almost feel sorry for him when he gets killed.
Especially how he gets killed. It's just,
I know. Like, just, when she...
She's all blessing, he, like... Yeah.
With it, like, and basically, like, you know, when you, Billy Loomis in the first one, obviously, he completely manipulates Stu, which is Matthew Lillard's character. And Mrs. Loomis does the same to Mickey. He's massively. Like, she's going to pay for my legal team and all this kind of shit. And then she's just like, nah, piss off, Mickey.
You've done all I need. Like,
You've done what I want. So,
yes. It's crazy, yeah. I was gutted how he died, and I was kind of gutted that Randy died off screen. I think Randy is a massive part of the Scream franchise, and he deserved. I think he deserved a bigger death.
I would have liked Randy to be kept in. I think if you're going to keep Dewey, Gale, and Sydney, I think you should have kept Randy as well. I think he would have been good in the third one. I would have liked to have seen him.
Well, you get him like the video, don't you? You get him just like a video of you. Yeah. If you've seen this, like, I'm dead.
But I would have. I don't know. I think they should have kept him in it. But, you know, oh well. But I think, like, I think one thing about his death, it was really brutal. Like, how all that blood, like, when they open it up and all that blood, and obviously, you know, we get the reaction that Gail gets. Like, she really went overkill with that one, Mrs. Loomis.
And that was the biggest... massively. And he was the first reoccurring character to be killed off. So that's your second kind of trigger warning. They're like, oh, wow, Randy's like a fan favourite. Like, anyone can die. Anyone can die.
And I like that they did it in the TV van. Because I liked the TV guy, you know, the camera guy.
Yeah.
Joel. Yeah, I thought that was really good, because he was obviously a bit of a comic relief to the whole thing. But I think they did it well. I think he did it well.
Apparently there's his idea to be like, I'm off, like, I ain't sticking around. I know what happened to your last camera guy. Which I think is right.
That's the logical thing to do.
You just wouldn't, like, oh, like, you've written a book about this. I know how this ends. I'm out of here. No job's, like, worth
And then he
this.
Comes back at the end. Oh, I'm here now. No, but he's the smartest one. He's the only smart one in the bloody thing. He's like, no, I'm going. I'm not sticking around for this. Like, do you know what I mean?
It'd be interesting to know if was she going to kill Randy all along, or was it only because he started bringing up, like, how Billy, her darling boy.
I think she did. Yeah, because there he was. She's Billy's a pansy-ass mama's boy and all this kind of stuff.
That scene's so great. I suppose the build-up to it's great. Just wouldn't mind seeing it on screen, like. But you see the van rocking and the kids playing the Ghetto Blasters, like.
Oh, I know. Perfect timing.
But
perfect timing.
That was a powerful. It's just bless him. He was great, and because I loved the earlier on with the them just all talking about movie sequels. It's the conversation of your mates, like.
That was a great scene.
What movie sequels are better? Almost again, like.
I knew they were going to say The Godfather Part 2.
It is better.
I knew they were going to say that. Like, I mean, better. Aliens. Okay. I am not a fan of the God. I only seen the Godfather films, I think, in the last 10 years. And everyone was going on about them. And I am not. I thought they were good. but I'm not a big mafia film type. I like The Irishman, I liked Donnie Brasco, but I'm just not. It's like when you tell people, but when you say to people, it's like the Beatles. I'm not a big fan of the Beatles. I think they're all right. But it's like when you say that, it's like there's this thing where people are like, I have to say I like The Godfather and I have to say I like the Beatles.
I don't like the Beatles.
No,
I think they're overrated. But yeah, I get what you mean. When someone bigs something up so much, you kind of, you're almost forced to like it before you've even seen it.
Yeah, and I mean, I watched them and I enjoyed them. I thought they were good, but I wasn't like, okay, you know, type thing. Aliens is obviously like one of my favourite films of all time, rather than Alien. So yeah, but I thought that was a really, because like you said, it was a kind of conversation. I did, like, my degree is in film, so I did a film degree. I don't remember having that conversation, but it was that type of thing where you sit and just chat about films. And you know, I remember the first time watching it, I was waiting to see what they were going to come out with.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? That way. But I knew they were going to come out with The Godfather. Because of, and Terminator 2, obviously.
They're the kind of films, whenever you say what sequels are better than their originals, apart from, well, Back to the Future 2, I don't think it was mentioned, but that's kind of potentially on par with
the first one. Yeah, that was a great film.
But Godfather 2 always get, those films always get mentioned. Terminator 2.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I love Terminator 2. I think it's a fucking great film. And obviously Aliens is a great film, but I just knew they were going to say, because everyone always goes on about Godfather 2, so they do. But yeah, no, I thought that was just a really good kind of scene, and I think it's good the way they talk about sequels, because it was a sequel, so obviously it's good for that part. But
it's probably exactly what you would have said, like when you hear Scream 2 is coming out, the first thing you say, like, oh yeah, but how many sequels are better than the original? Like,
well, yeah, because some films you're just like my episode before this was You're Next, and everyone was on about a sequel, and I was like, no, they shouldn't do a sequel, and they didn't, and I was really glad about that. And I think sometimes they should just leave stuff well alone.
Yeah,
you know, or even after a sequel, leave stuff like I know this is not very horror, but Frozen, they've done Frozen 1 and 2, two great fucking films, like, but don't do a third. Yeah,
it's cash,
exactly,
it's the cash cow, merchandise sales, and it's mental. But yeah, there's so many films that should be left alone, and some films are like, oh, I'm kind of glad they did with a sequel, but
yeah,
some films, if you finish the story perfectly, we don't need any more.
And sometimes they really do. Like, and then I remember I did an episode of Wrong Turn, and I found out when I did that episode that they had like 7.
Yeah,
I knew there was.
I think we
three,
did the trailer for the newest one, and I was like, oh my god, there's like 6 before this. I remember the first one.
Yeah, was it 6? Yeah,
but like,
yeah,
this is crazy. They're just, I suppose it's just easy. They've got the title. So many of these films could probably be their own unique film, but like, you know what, if we just call it an, it sounds like a Wrong Turn film. We'll see if we can get
caught. Call it that, yeah.
Because there's no recurring characters, really, because they always die, and it just, but yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, so I thought, yeah, I think the conversation they had is probably a conversation, like you said, a lot of people have had with their mates and stuff like that. But, What did you think of the whole Mrs. Loomis thing? Did you like it that she was?
I was.
Kind of,
I was like, she was the harder one to kind of work out was the killer. Mm. And watching it back, as you say, apart from being kept away from Sid and not always being the action, but I liked the fact that it was a realistic motive. I think you're led to believe it's just lunatics kind of recreating for the sake of recreating.
Yeah.
But
yeah. Copycat. Yeah.
There's a real motive, and it was because, like Billy in the first one saying, like, you know what, like, your mum slept with my dad, and I never got to like see my mum because she left. It's that kind of realizing moment, like, you killed my darling boy, and this is why. But obviously they go too stupid.
It's believable.
Go too stupid in Scream 3. We're like, I'm your long lost brother.
I did like Scream 3, though. I know everyone's like, but
I don't hate Scream 3. I hate the fact that he reckons he, almost as you say, he manipulated Billy.
Mm.
And also for Billy to have Stu. I did not like that whatsoever. And I think the killer was only in like 3 scenes. It was almost impossible to work out it was him.
Mm. Yeah, no.
It was definitely more comedy, Scream 3. But as soon as you said it, I'm like, the brother you don't even know I've got, I was like, oh, shut up. Like,
reaching.
That's the best thing you can do. Whereas Scream 4 was kind of a return to form, kind of. But, yeah, I thought she did a cracking job at it, and it really did hit home, like, oh, shit, you're Billy's mum. Because we never saw Billy's mum in the first one. You don't...
No.
You can never put two and two together.
Ah, you don't know who she is, do you?
So when she says it, she's like, oh, I just hope Scream 5 isn't Stu's mum.
I know. No, when that whole scene at the end, when obviously they find out who it is and... She dies, but I thought, well, we think she's dead,
yeah.
And they do that whole thing where they always come back and Mickey comes back and they shoot the shit out of him. But how psychotic was it when Sydney shoots her right between the eyes? Because I thought to myself, if she is alive, wouldn't it kind of be better to maybe tie her hands behind her back or something and let the police have her? But she's like, no, I'm gonna fucking kill her.
No, I thought it was perfect. Like, yeah, just in case. This has happened too many times where they've come back and
But in the real world, do you know what I mean? They'd be like, why'd you shoot her? That's murder, man. Because technically she murdered her.
And Cotton Weary's reaction, just like, whoa!
That's the point. Actually, I was going to ask you about that. What did you think of Cotton Weary?
I thought he was really good in it. Obviously, he never speaks in one. You kind of see him on camera. Mm. So for him to be on here, he's really good. Well, I think he does a good enough part where I care a lot that he died at the beginning of Scream 3.
Yeah. Spoiler.
He's you know, he's the perfect motive that it could have been him. You put me away. You blamed me. He's another one where you think, could it be him? And
yeah, no,
I think he's the biggest red herring to think he looks like he could be a killer.
And he has I never know how to pronounce his name, but Liev Schreiber. He has this look about him that when he is doing that whole you owe me 60 minutes and all this kind of stuff, and then when basically Sydney's about to die and he's like, guess that Diane Sawyer interview is looking quite good now, and he's got this, he has this look all the time, so he does in everything he does, where he just, if he's being an absolute dick, he plays it so well. And I just think, you want your 15 minutes of fame so badly that you're willing to let this girl be murdered.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And it's just so good. And then when, obviously, it all kind of calms down and Gail, you know, because Gail had been shot and fallen down the stage, and then Gail gets up and he's just like, oh, I hope there's no more. Like, he's all scared about what's going on.
Oh, he did a really good job. Because... apart from the other red herring, obviously the boyfriend Derek is probably the second kind of, you think it's him, is it him? He's only getting cut on the arm. They did a very good, but then...
Well, they say that I just read this today, this isn't me. I read that today that the reason, another clue that it was Mickey was the fact that Derek was only cut on the arm because Mickey and Derek were such good friends that he didn't want to kill him, but then he had to at the end. Because of how it kind of all played out. So,
because Derek and Hallie originally were going to be the two killers.
Yeah,
they were going to be the two killers.
That would have made no sense.
And I think they were supposed to kind of, everyone ends up being dead. So yeah, there was never going to be a Scream 3. I think I would have been like the boyfriend again. So I'm kind of glad they kind of changed it.
I was like, nah, it wouldn't have made sense if it was him. It would have been too obvious if it was the boyfriend again. Because obviously, you know, when he's tied up, after he gets, you know, that prank by his frat brothers, because they gave away the letters, and he's tied up. And I'm like, No, and then she doesn't believe him, obviously, because she's got trust issues and all that kind of stuff. So I kind of think it's, yeah, no, it wouldn't have been good if it was him. It wouldn't have been good at all.
You would have trust issues. You've just kind of, well, you've slept with a mass killer, like. So
yeah, completely.
I think it's a proper great film. I love the fact they still kept the voice actor, Roger Jackson. Very creepy voice. But yeah, I'm just glad they didn't go with the boyfriend again to be the killer.
Do you know what was interesting about the very end of it, which I'd never noticed before? So she, you know, everyone's dead that needs to be dead, and she's coming out, and then Gail goes to Dewey. Do you remember he's in the ambulance, and she goes to him. Cotton is surrounded by press because he's like, oh, there's a story, there's a price. And she's on her own. And do you notice that the shot, kind of the aerial shot, where she's kind of walking on her own, and for until the last kind of second, she's just alone all the time. And I thought that was a really interesting, I never thought of this before. I thought that was a really interesting insight until Scream 3, because in Scream 3, she's alone. She's living isolated, apart from her dad. And I think Dewey knows where she is or something. Like, her dad does and someone else. I can't remember who else. She's alone because she's living out in the middle of nowhere. She's got alarms and all this kind of stuff. And she's just a counsellor by phone.
Yeah.
She doesn't go into a job. And I thought that was quite interesting, actually. Cause, like,
I never
she's...
thought of it like that. Yeah, it's pretty...
No, I didn't either until, like, this viewing. Because, like, Hallie's dead. Randy's dead. Derek's dead. Mickey's dead. You know, and Gail's off with Dewey.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Cotton's getting his 5 minutes.
5 minutes of fame.
Yeah, and she's on her own. You know, I never thought of that until this one. She's just walking off. And then at the very end, you kind of see people walk towards her. But yeah, and then in Scream 3, she kind of has to come out of hiding because she's alone.
Yeah. Yeah, I've never thought of it like that.
No, I didn't either until just watching it.
So obviously, Scream 3, she was hardly in it because she had conflict in, which they should have just postponed the film.
Oh, was that what it was?
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
She had a scheduling conflict. That's why she was not in a lot. And she was kind of, I suppose it works perfectly with the end of Scream 2. And I don't know if that was written in for her to be secluded all on her own. But
yeah,
I suppose everyone around her, it's good. And I suppose there's no one left to trust because she probably doesn't want to be close to anyone else anymore.
No, exactly. Because, like, I mean, I think out of them all, Dewey is the only one she would. But Jesus Christ, every time he goes near her, he's hacked to bits. You know, that man's got more lives than a cat, for God's sake.
I found, like, whatever they did to him in Scream 2 improved his walking in Scream 3. It's like the nerve damage was kind of improved a little bit, like, and he is
yoga. It was yoga.
He really does play on the limp in Scream 2. When it comes to Scream 3, all of a sudden, like, you're moving a little bit more.
Yeah. Like, he just believes that he's been working on his self-improvement.
That's fixed you a bit.
A new film sorted him out. Cool. So is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, I just think it is a great sequel. I've not seen it in the Scream films. I suppose, sorry, we told you everything that happens. But I definitely feel, if you love horror, and obviously you do because you're listening to this show, you've got to check out Scream 2.
Unfortunately, it's
not on any streaming site, so I had to polish off the DVD, which is
on Amazon.
It's weird. I have, like, probably 1,000 DVDs, like, to my right, but it's a bit of a ball ache to put them in. It's like, I own them because I have to, but it feels like, oh, I've got to put the DVD in.
You're so old school.
So old school, like, oh, I'm waiting for it to load. But yeah, just great films. Just Wes Craven's great. I don't know if you noticed that the person interviewed, because I always knew that Wes Craven was in the hospital scene, but I didn't know until this, and I read the trivia that Kevin Williamson, the writer, is the guy interviewing Cotton Weary in the studio.
Yeah, I didn't know that either until today.
Which, that's the only real thing to kind of add But
I like those little bits, though. I like those little bits.
I love the fun fact.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, I do. Cool. Okay. So for anyone looking for you on your podcast, where can they find you?
They can find us on Twitter at Paul and Griff Show. Or they can find us on Instagram at Paul and Griff Show. It's a long story why the names are different. Twitter just doesn't like as many characters. And I made Instagram first. But yeah, we love films. We're on everywhere you can listen to podcasts. Just search in Paul and Griff and there we are. If you find us on Twitter and Instagram, the link in the bio will take you to all of our links.
Brilliant. Cool. Well, thanks for coming on and I'll have to get you on again for another
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. I'll chat to you soon. Bye.
Bye.
And for my podcast promo this week, it is one that I really enjoy listening to. It makes me laugh. They cover great films. They cover one of my favorite topics, which is horror movies. It is the Horror Project Podcast.
Hello, I'm Phil.
And I'm Laura.
And we host the Horror Project Podcast.
It's a weekly show. It comes out every Friday.
Yeah, and we review films old and new with the occasional interview with horror movie insiders.
We have loads of fun features. We have a body bag award where we rate our favourite on-screen kills and deaths. We have quizzes, trivias about the film that we're reviewing that week.
Yeah, loads of cool stuff. You can find us on iTunes, Spotify, all good podcast platforms. If that sounds like your thing, stop by, give us a try.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.
And don't forget to rate and review on iTunes and give them some stars and have a good old listen. And I'd like to say thanks for listening to me. And don't forget to rate and review me on iTunes and give me some nice feedback. It's always appreciated. But if you want to find more of me, you can find me on Instagram as Once Upon a Nightmare Podcast, on Twitter and Letterboxd as A Nightmare Pod, on email as onceuponanightmarepod@gmail.com and on Facebook as Once Upon a Nightmare. Thanks for listening and I will chat to you soon. Bye.
The Pod Breed Network is strictly for the small podcasts that are up and coming in the vast world of podcasting. Pod Breed is made up of many diverse podcasts coming together to achieve the same goal of being the best damn podcast network on the planet. Find out more at podbreed.com.